For so long I carried the weight of my past, crippled by burdens like stones on my back. I thought I had fallen too far from your grace.
Welcome to Recovery Radio, where we have hope for you today.
When I was lost, so searching, you were the ground beneath my feet. When I was a blind man begging, you were the eye so I could see.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Worldwide Recovery Radio. I am your host, Sean, and I am a grateful believer in Jesus Christ, and I am just so thankful to be here in the studio with you guys today. Whether it be evening, morning, daytime, I pray that you guys are having a blessed day and that your day is just filled with the Lord. So, today in the studio, we have Engineer Bill.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning, Bill. How was your week?
Very good.
Good. I'm glad. Also in the back, we have Mama Pat, who's answering the phones and doing what she does best, keeping me in line and keeping the show in line. We also have Tom in the back. Unfortunately, our live streaming today is not working. So Deb, who always is willing to come in and give us a hand, isn't here because of that. And I want to thank the rest of the staff, Mike and Polly. Of course, I love you guys. They're great. John and Terry, who do all the background stuff, all the technical stuff in the background and everything else. They're great people. I love you guys too. And of course, Val, who we haven't seen for a little while. We're hoping to have her on the show maybe. Just love everybody and just your guys are a great team, and that's what we do. So I'm going to open us up in some prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we love you so much. We are just so grateful for everything you do in our lives. We are just so grateful for this show. We are grateful for our guest today. And we just love you, Lord. And we just pray that this show just goes well and that you just continue to fill us full of you. Less of us and more of you. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. So today we got some shout outs today. Tomorrow is going to be a really big day. Tomorrow is Father's Day. And I just want to give a big, huge shout out to every father out there who... you know who you are. Love you, Dad. Also, I want to give a big shout out to the moms who have to put up with dads. without the moms, we wouldn't be anywhere. So I want to just say love you to family and love you to fathers especially.
Yeah.
So, Bill, do you want to go over our wonderful sponsors and who we have sponsoring this show today?
Yes. I want to say a big thank you to Easy Rider Motorcycle Testing. They're now hiring riders, and you can reach them on the phone at 928-706-4553. Sunshine RV, they have experienced sales and service with Kyle and the gang. They're located at 2995 Maricopa Avenue, and they have a north side location at Highway 95 out at the shops of Havasu near Dillard's. And they're also on the web at sunshinerv.com, and you can reach them on the phone at 928-855-6648. Ace Pest Control, serving Lake Havasu City for over 20 years with termite pest and weed control. You can reach them on the phone at 928-680-0988 and on the web at acepestcontrolaz.com. Hilltop Community Church for supporting Recovery Radio with t-shirts and hats, and they're located at 3180 McCulloch Boulevard North, also on the web at hilltoplhc.com. And we have an anonymous sponsor. God knows who you are, and we thank you for your sponsorship as well.
Thank you, Bill. We are welcome. So grateful for our sponsors and everything they do for us. Without you guys, we couldn't do this. So, that being said, we are a live call-in show. I'm going to throw the number out there. It's 1-800-721-9313. Our local number is 928-855-9313. 9110. This is a live call-in show. We'd love to hear from you, or you just need to call in and have some prayer. Mama Pat's in the back, ready to receive your calls. And if we get a caller, we also give away a hat and a t-shirt, one or the other. And we'd love for you guys to have a hat or a t-shirt. They're really, really cool. They have the R&R symbol. And it says Hope for Today underneath it, which is really, really awesome. So, we are here to help one another. Recovery Radio is here to help with the life struggles and our simple nature that affects our lives and the lives of others. In Ecclesiastes, two people are better than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. So once again, only Jesus can fix us. We are here to support one another. Share in each other's burdens, it says in Galatians. Come together and encourage one another in Hebrews. And build each other up, 1 Thessalonians 5:11. And lift each other up in prayer. That's what we're here to do today, you guys. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And if you don't believe it, you can ask me all day long. I will tell you that as long as you surrender to Him, He will completely and totally change your life. He has changed mine. I know He's changed Bill's here sitting in the studio.
Oh, yeah.
And He's also changed our guests, too, who we're going to get to in a minute. Our scripture for today is Ephesians 1:7. In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches and graces. We have God's grace. That's the NIV version. Once again, this is a live call-in show. You guys can reach us on the web also at RecoveryRadioLHC.com. We have a bunch of different avenues and things going on there. A lot of different resources that are really, really important. We are better together, number one. Number two, if you need a meeting, get to a meeting. Sobriety is very, very important in our walk with Jesus Christ, and I encourage it completely and totally. It helps me on a daily basis to be sober, to deal with all the trials and tribulations that I go through.
Amen.
So, all that being said, we have an awesome guest here this morning, somebody who kind of look up to a little bit, somebody that's been walking with the Lord a lot longer than I have. I've talked to him quite a few times, and so that being said, I want to introduce John to the show.
Good morning.
Good morning, John. How are you doing today?
Wonderful.
Wonderful. That's awesome. We are so blessed to have you here on the radio show.
Thank you.
I know this is your first time. You're my actual kind of first guest by myself. So I might be a little nervous, okay, but it'll be a good show. Let's dive into this. You ready for this?
Yeah, I think so.
You think so?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Let's talk a little bit. So you are how old?
71, and it'll be 72 in a couple weeks.
Oh yeah?
Is that wow.
That's exciting.
Yes.
That's very, very exciting. And I bring your age up because we'll get into all that, yes. Your testimony and everything, yes. Else, because the timeline and back when everything took place for you. So let's talk about what took place before Christ. What was going on in your life? And let's talk about the little bit of, a little bit of the nonsense.
Well, I went through a kind of a hellish beginning of my life. Mm-hmm. I was abandoned by my parents. Then reacquainted to my mother, and she married an alcoholic for the third time. They weren't parents. My grandmother raised me, basically. And basically, I went through life learning everything with hard knocks. Mm. Got into drugs and didn't get out of drugs until God took me away from it. He saved me.
Yeah, he has a habit of doing that.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah.
If we listen, he does it.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. And we'll talk about more than that, too. So in your life, this time period and everything going on, broken home, mm-hmm. I know a lot of callers out there have experienced that. Mm-hmm. A lot of listeners, I mean, not callers. Yeah. Listeners have experienced that. And I know for me, it was a broken home. Something about that. It's hard on children, and you know, it took me a little while to actually get over that. It took me actually becoming an adult to get over that. And I know, Bill, you came from a broken home too, didn't you?
Well, my mom passed away just before my 13th birthday, and then my dad remarried a few years later, and She was an interesting woman, to say the least. She had an alcohol problem. And she would beat my younger siblings. She didn't lay a hand on me because I was about the same size as her at 15. So,
lucky.
Plus I was in football and, you know, I could have put her through a wall if I wanted, because she wasn't a very big woman. So, but she was tall, about my height at 15. So, you know, she was afraid of me actually. And
probably
so,
a good thing.
Yeah.
So she slapped me once, and I told her if she ever did it again, I'd kill her. So she never did it again. And so I left the house when I was 18. And so they ended up getting divorced when I got remarried. So it was after my divorce, actually. So, yeah, it was an interesting childhood, to say the least. So
at that point for you, childhood, mm-hmm. wasn't that great and everything else? So at some point you became an adult. Tell me about that. Tell me about young adulthood and what was going on there.
At the end of my drug use and all the other things I was into, I was going through a lot of court battles and stuff like that. And I felt this need. I had gotten married. My wife had to leave me and eventually divorce me because I was dragging her through my world. And it was very ugly at that time. At the time, we had a son. And we spent the next 5 years going through some stuff, ended up reconciling and then having another child. And basically, I threw her out, told her to take her God and get out of my house. Mm-hmm. And ended up, basically, I was in court battles, and I was looking at my life. Mm-hmm. And basically, it didn't fall apart on me, but I could see a need, that big void that you get inside. Mm-hmm. I saw that need, and I told myself, I said, you know what? I need to go see my boy. Mm-hmm. And I showed up at the place where she lived and my son lived, but at the time there, this was a big, I mean, Calvary Chapel had people, I mean, there thousands of people, and I had thousands of people praying for me because my wife, she was a part of that place, and I showed up and this one man, mm-hmm. God spoke to him. He set me down on a lawn and he started talking to me and just going over.
So let's talk about your wife a little bit. How long were you guys married up to that point?
The divorce happened in that 5 year period, but we had been married maybe 2 years.
And how long did you guys know each other?
Probably 3 years. Mm-hmm. Dates are kind of hard on me now because I don't remember.
All right.
But it was a while ago.
It was a while ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't feel bad. I have a hard time remembering yesterday, let alone.
Yeah. We laugh at each other now, me and my wife, because we don't remember things. But this man set me down and started speaking to me, and God came down and touched me, and it all started making sense. In the end, he just sat there and spoke to me. Then he started to pray for me. And we were by ourselves, sitting on this lawn. When it was over with, I was surrounded by lots of people.
Yeah.
The whole people in this apartment company, there's at least 70 people standing around me. And God just came down and touched me. Mm. And I looked up and I gave God my life. I said, I've got to change now. And God changed me instantly. Mm. I mean, it was instantaneous. It's not. It's hard to tell people about how you get saved. Because people, you have to grow into it. You grow with God. Not that I didn't grow after that, because I grew more in that time, because basically disciples attached themselves to me and taught me everything I was needed to know before I went to prison.
Wow. So for I understand what you're saying there. For me, I'm going to reflect on my side of it, wherein, you know, that moment when I cried out to God and I finally just let go. You know, God peered his face through the ceiling. The room lit up in his glory, which a light that I can't describe because it's not, you know, a fixture light. It's a light.
Yeah.
And it was a comforting light. And God came in and when he poured his spirit into me, which I didn't know at the time, it was the spirit being poured into me by any means. He poured his spirit into me and it just released so much. There just so much took place right there. And that's probably what you're describing right there is just the let go and the spirit just coming in and clean, almost like cleaning house. You know, the immediate, you know, you walk into a house and there's trash all over the place and everything else in the living room. And it's like God sent the spirit in to come in and just kind of pick up the living room at this point. You know, you're free of this. You're free of this. For me, it took a little while for me to be able to walk in that newness and to understand it. But I knew something had taken place. And is that kind of what took place right there for you?
Yeah, and a lot of people's walk, it takes a while to get to that foot of the cross and watch the blood come down and cover you. I saw that.
Yeah, that's a big thing, yeah, too.
And I made a commitment that day. God filled me right away because he knew I needed it.
Right.
Because of my life, he knew I needed every bit I could get in so I could cut out that life.
Mm-hmm.
And I ran from my past.
Mm-hmm.
I ran,
mm-hmm.
you know, and he showed me who Christ was and what it meant to me. And I still carry that to today. I tell people, you need to get to the foot of the cross. You need to see the blood that covered our sins.
Mm-hmm.
You need to see that. It's real.
Yeah, that's a huge step. Surrender.
Surrender.
Surrender is everything. I know I tried so many times before. I remember saying the sinner's prayer and going, I know I need God in my life, and it just nothing. I thought things were changing. I thought things were right, but that day, one of the only dates that I actually remember, you know what I'm saying? November 8th at 3 o'clock in the morning in 2017. And I remember it very, very clearly just for that reason. Because it was life changing for me. I'm going to just encourage you guys out there, the listeners out there, that this is a live call-in show. Our phone number is 1-800-721-9313. I just want to encourage you guys. We're here for questions or even telling us your part of what took place in your life or even what God's done and helped you in your walk with him and what he's helped you with as we continue with this show. So,
you know, John, before we go any further, there's a Psalm 34:18 that says, the Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit.
Yes.
And brother, what happened to you on that lawn in that apartment complex? Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's nigh unto them that are broken. Mm-hmm. Yeah. For sure.
You know, brokenness is where it got me to. That's how it led me.
We have to be broken before he'll pour into our lives because there's no way for him to fit if we don't think we're broken because then we don't need him.
Correct.
And we do need him.
Oh, daily.
Yeah.
I don't know about you guys, but I need.
Oh, yeah. Every minute of the day.
This is a daily thing. And I can tell when I'm not in the spirit. And it just, it's kind of an icky feeling for me.
Yeah.
And if I'm not being, you know, surrendered to his will or even falling, then we're going to talk about a little bit of obedience and everything else. Being obedient. Mm-hmm. If we're not being obedient, then we're not being surrendered.
Yeah.
So you got saved. Let's talk about the time period right there before you continue going. That was the late 60s, early 70s? Or early 70s?
Early 70s.
So you got saved right about, I believe you told me, in 74?
Yep.
So you got saved right before I was born. Okay, so this is, If you guys don't know, I'm 45 years old. So he's been saved 45 years, a little longer than 45 mm-hmm. years. And I think that's just such an awesome thing. It really is. For mm-hmm. me, it's just that's an astonishment. That really is. It's just, but you can see how God works. Mm-hmm. So during that time period, the 70s, let's talk about the culture during that time. That was a lot of...
Jesus movement, mm-hmm. Vietnam War. I mean, there were so many things happening in the mm-hmm. early 70s.
Yeah.
A lot of drugs, love, and alcohol, everything that was taking place, too. Yeah.
It was after Woodstock, you know, mm-hmm. so you got the whole, you know, Beatles and Elvis and the music and the sex, drugs, and rock and roll mm-hmm. phase, plus the Jesus movement. So, yeah, it was quite the time.
Ooh. Yeah. Interesting.
Yes.
So that during that time period, I know for me in my time period, I thought it was rough. But back then, with the culture being the way that it is and everything else, mm-hmm. I'm sure it was even rougher.
Yeah, there were riots. The country mm-hmm. was just in a total uproar from one end to the other.
Yeah. And God uses that. Yeah. You know that? Mm-hmm. Especially out there, you know, God uses that. He saves people, as we're talking to John mm-hmm. about that. Mm-hmm. So... during that time, what was your life like? You said you were going to prison. What were you going to go to prison for? Can I ask that question?
Possession with intent.
So you were trying to contribute with society at that point?
Oh, I contributed. I contributed. I even have a guilt that I know God's covered and forgiven, that I was a part of the problem.
Right.
I was a part of that problem. And it took me almost 10 years of my walk with the Lord to actually release all that, mm-hmm. saying, thank you, God, because you have released me from that guilt. I was convicted and sentenced to 15 to life, 15 to life, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And right away, the judge ordered that I be put in an evaluation thing out of state prison. And basically, I was in prison for 45 days.
Cool. That's it.
And God took me right out of it, put me in the courtroom, and the judge said, I'm releasing you.
Wow.
And go, God. Uh-huh. Go, God.
Right.
Because without that, I would have had to serve minimum probably 15 of that. Wow. And I'd have missed, we wouldn't have had my third daughter. We wouldn't have had, none of that would have happened.
Right.
And that became a very big part of our life. Mm-hmm. So he sent me back up. We remarried because she finally got the divorce, and I guess I must have signed the paper sometime during that. But then we started this walk with Jesus.
Because mm-hmm. now you're both saved, right?
Yeah.
She was saved.
Yeah, well, she was saved before. She was walking with the Lord. And we got saved. And, I mean, I got saved and we started walking. I committed. I said, Lord, I will never, ever walk away. Mm-hmm. And today, I have never, ever walked away. Do I fail in my walk? Mm-hmm. Miserably. Mm-hmm. I do fail. But I will never take my eyes off of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Never. It won't happen because I know he's real. Mm-hmm. He's real.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
No matter how I feel, he's real.
And, amen.
Yeah. I'm just, I want to encourage you guys that are listening right now that without Jesus, you know, we can't do it. And we're going to fall. We're going to fail. We're going to fall on our faces all the time. I have quite a few times. I've only been doing this for a little while. But it's awesome and good when we're walking with Jesus Christ. Hi, Mama. How you doing?
I'm good.
You want this?
I want that. Wow, what a show. You guys are on fire. We're getting calls back there. Most of our folks today do not want to be on air, but congratulations. I want to tell you, this show is hitting a home run. And we got a call from Steve from Yucca, who's one of our air team members. Wonderful fellow. But he's so excited because his mom... who even older than you and I, John, and I'm older than John, she's 91 years old, and she got hooked up to where her radio is picking up KNLB over there in Barstow, which we know it. And yeah. She's listening. So a shout out to her today. God bless you. Keep listening. And when I said to Steve on the phone, well, you know, John's new on the air right now. I couldn't say one more word. The man just started praying. I mean, this Steve is just wonderful. So God bless all the brothers and sisters out there. You guys are doing great.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Mama.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen.
Love when you come in the middle of the show. You know that, right? So, this point, walking with Christ. That's one more thing I want to talk about that era. So, Pastor Chuck Smith, a great pastor as far as I'm concerned, started Calvary Chapel during this time, which ignited a fire that burnt. I mean, in California, it was just burning bright. I remember he was. I've heard. And I'm seeing some stuff where he was doing stuff on the beaches. He was doing revivals. He was just a man that was just on fire for the Lord and just bringing, you know, people were just wanting to know what he had. Mm-hmm. That was such a big thing. Let's talk about that. Is that what you guys experienced too at that time period?
Yes. I studied under Chuck for a long period of time. Greg Laurie, you know, Mike McIntosh. You know, they were all, well, Greg and Mike, and well, Mike had a life just like mine. Mm-hmm. He was my first counselor. He was the pastor of San Diego Calvary. And him and Diane had the same life that me and Jackie had. It just mirrored each other. So he was really helpful. But I was really mentored by a man who's now gone, but he would read me the Bible every night after I was saved. Every night he was reading the Bible to me, reading it to me, teaching me. And he did that for probably the first 6 months of my walk. We became very good friends. Mm-hmm. And we need the people around us, the family. Mm-hmm. This is God's family.
Yes.
You know, he's the Father. Jesus is our Savior, and he gets us in through his blood. He gets us to heaven, even though we fail.
Right.
And basically, as you study, as I grew, I got closer and closer to what the reality was of my time here. Realized that I'm just a visitor here.
Just passing through.
Just going through.
Yep.
And my job, I've been a part and a leader in every church I've ever been in.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know why, because I'm not educated. High school was over at ninth, before ninth grade even got started. God gave me a business where I had to run.
Mm-hmm.
Some employees, quite a few. He got me through 46 years of that.
Mm-hmm.
He gave me everything I possibly could need to survive. Gave me a family. Gave me roofs over my head. And gave me a family in my church. Created what I call a family.
Mm-hmm.
The people around me, the people trying to understand what God is doing and trying to learn more and more about what he's doing. Yeah. And I'm not a reader.
Right.
So I absorb. And I have a lot of teachers. Most of my friends are pastors.
Mm-hmm.
That's a God thing.
Yeah.
Because he knew I needed that.
Right.
He knows I wasn't going to read. He knows I'm very stubborn. And he knows I needed knowledge. And I've acquired most of my knowledge from my family. You know, they teach me. I listen well.
Mm-hmm.
And they teach me.
You do. I do say that. And I know in our connection group, you don't always, you never read, but you listen. You are a listener. You are a true listener.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it doesn't matter what it is. God's going to use it.
Mm-hmm.
God knows who we are. Yep. God knows our ins and outs. God knows our faults. God mm-hmm. knows what we'll do, and he knows how to get our attention. I know for me, he can mm-hmm. get my attention any day of the week. sometimes I just sit there and go, okay, God, and just kind of brush it off. And then usually somebody else, which we talk about family, somebody else from church, which is usually, you know, the people I've grown close to over the last couple months, mm-hmm. will usually come up and tell me exactly what God has told me, and you mm-hmm. need to move forward in it. And I'm like, okay. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
That's the human in me is okay, God. You know, you're not really going to do this, but, you know, the more that I walk with him, mm-hmm. The more that I am grateful for the people he puts in our place, in our way, to get our attention, to get us to move forward.
Yeah.
That's why I want to say that it's so important, you guys, that if you're not plugged into a church, to please get mm-hmm. plugged in. Mm-hmm. It is a life changer. It will help you so much. It says so many times in the Bible that we need to be together because, number one, we are family. Number two, we learn from each other. There's probably somebody at the church that has been through the exact same thing you've been through that is farther into the walk than you are and is willing to sit there. And everybody is willing to sit there and talk to you and help you through it, pray with you, and maybe even give you a little bit of advice about what they did. And I can guarantee every person that is walking with God will always tell you to look towards him and to focus on him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You focus on Jesus because he's right. We're writing a story. Mm-hmm. We have a story. Every one of us have different story. Yeah. Every one of us has different gifts. And we all need to communicate with each other, because all of our gifts work better when we're working together toward God. Mm-hmm. We're all going to be in heaven soon, and the world is coming to an end. We can just look around. We're doing a bad job as humans right now. Mm-hmm. But when we become spirit and we go to heaven to be with God and to worship God and to praise him, we better have it together. Mm-hmm. Our spirits better be aimed and only on him.
Yes. Yes. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus.
Period.
Period. Period.
Correct. Thank you, Bill.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's kind of yep. catchy, isn't it?
Yes, yeah. It is.
I'm glad that
you brought that up. Yeah.
Thank you, Pastor David.
Yeah.
If you're listening.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
Yes.
I want to give him a shout out because I love that guy.
Happy Father's Day.
And and enjoy your vacation, because I know he's on vacation right now, recharging his batteries and getting. But that man is an awesome man. I love
yes.
him.
Yes.
He's very
yes.
spirit-filled man.
Yeah.
So as we're talking about ministry, let's talk about ministry a little bit. What do you do? What have you done in ministry? Because I know you've been in quite a few churches. Mm-hmm. And you're usually working with pastors, which mm-hmm. now I'm getting to a point that that's all I want to work with is I want to be as close to pastors as possible, because I want to know how they do it, because they've been, you know, pastors have come under attack a lot more than we do as regular, mm-hmm. Regular believers, as far mm-hmm. as I'm concerned, because they're given the word of God. I mean, they're trying to mm-hmm. reach out to people as much as possible. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that. What do you do in ministry, or what have you done in ministry at this point?
Well, God had showed me just that perfect fact. People really don't understand how hard it is to be a pastor, because they're under constant attack. Mm-hmm. Okay? And God placed me in several churches where I was at the right arm on every pastor. I love my friends and my pastors because they fed into me, but they would look at me and say, "You're my pastor," and I would always laugh at them, going, "That doesn't make any sense." But okay, right? Yeah, okay. You're the one with the knowledge here, okay? But my gift was giving and an encouragement and being there and having the ministry's back. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you get frustrated when you watch people go to church and they say they don't get anything out of it. And I've always told them, well, then you must have not been listening. Mm-hmm. Because God talks to every individual in that room. And he talks a different story to everybody in that room with the same pastor, with the same sermon. Mm-hmm. I said, if you're not listening, you're not getting what you need that day. So you better be listening. Yeah. Again, I am a listener, mm-hmm. so I see it that way. That's not with everybody. But I was like the last church I was at, I was in the prayer room afterwards with the pastor, and I would help the load by praying with people, new people, meeting people. And basically, I was always in the front, greeting people, loving them, taking them to the side to pray if they needed it, whatever was going on. And I just made a visit back to California after being out of my church there for 2 years, walked in, and God showed me something. He showed me that you never, and this is what, it took me 2 years to get over this. I just got over it. I went back. That family's never left my heart, mm-hmm. and it never will, mm-hmm. because God said so. We made a bond. God moved me here. And this is a God move. Me being in Havasu is a God move. Mm-hmm. So, and now, and finding Hilltop is a God move. Mm-hmm. Because it's my type of church, mm-hmm. where people want to love on each other. They want to learn more about God, and they want to understand the covering of our sins.
All right.
Once we get there,
mm-hmm. yeah,
we're solid.
Yeah, we're good. Yeah. Well, church is just, I know, so important for me. Mm-hmm. Without it, I would be nowhere. And family, the people that you meet there and the people you grow close to, is really, really awesome, because we need to be able to bond. I know for me, if I didn't find those people, I would probably, mm-hmm. even though I'm saved, still be wandering in the desert, going through the things that I went through. Mm-hmm. For me also, God moving me here in October was mm-hmm. a complete and total God move. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't sure, but, you know, God kept telling me, and then he put people in my path once again to tell me the same thing, that you need to go. And I'm like, oh, okay. Yeah, but I did my normal, you know, okay, God. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about that, so that means God has a plan and a purpose. Mm-hmm. You know, because God doesn't make mistakes.
Nope.
And God's plan is always way, way better than our plan. I can tell you that today. Yep. Let me remind you guys once again that this is a live call-in show. We would love to hear from you guys. Our phone number is 1-800-721-9313. And our local number is 928-855-9110. So you talk about serving and being up front. For me, that was a difficult, when God was like, I want you to greet. And I'm like, really? You want me to greet? And he's like, yeah. So I go to the staff and I go, use me, you know, use me for your will at this point. Cause God wants me to do this. And I was a wreck going up and doing it, because I'm not a big person fan. I don't like people. So for me, it was very nerve-wracking, but I went ahead and did it because God told me to do it. And of course, he put somebody else on my path that told me the exact same thing. So I went up and I told him that. So I started out with doing one service out there, just greeting, shaking hands. And then God was like, I want you to do more. I'm like, well, more. What's more? What's your idea of more, God? And he's like, well, how about all the services? And I'm like, all of them. Okay. I don't know if I can do that. He thought, no, it'll be great. It'll be good. So I started doing it, and I have found so much fulfillment in being out there and greeting people and shaking people's hands and being able to, and just, hi, how are you doing? It's great to see you today, just with a smile on my face. And then seeing the smile on their face, mm-hmm. is just unbelievable. also being part of the prayer team and everything, being able to just see what people are doing, you know, and just being able to say, hey, you know, can I pray for you? Are you doing okay? And then, of course, there's the regulars. I love seeing the regulars. The people that I serve with there is really, really, they're great people. Everybody mm-hmm. is just really, really great. Everybody that God has put around me to serve is just really, really awesome. Mm-hmm. In fact, I look forward now, being the guy that I am that didn't like people, that didn't like things going on, look forward to being there Sunday morning to serve. I love going and serving now. And that's just so amazing because that's a God thing, you guys.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I didn't like that. I didn't want to do that. But now that I'm doing it, you can't ask me to give it up. I would probably kick and scream more than when I kicked and screamed when he told me to do it. And I was kicking and screaming, believe me. So there's just so much fulfillment there. And I just love just being with people now, being with people that are like-minded and just being able to see that and see people grow and see people serve. So I want to encourage you guys as you're listening, if you have a church, go as much as you can and serve. I encourage you to serve. It's just, that is the most fulfilling part, and it doesn't have to be a lot, you guys. Just start out small. Let God work in you and let God show you what is taking place and what you can do and what your gifts are to be able to serve people, because we're not all pastors. We're not all people that can greet. Maybe you just be a part of the media team of it, or just something where you can find your little niche and just be able to go and to serve or be part of the prayer team. I just want to encourage you guys of all that, because it's just, that's awesome and great. So all that, let's continue here. So you had a daughter after you got saved, didn't you?
Yes.
And you want to talk about that and what took place right there?
Yeah, she was, God gave her to us after we got gotten back together. And she was not only a daughter, she was a good friend. Mm-hmm. And she had a difficult life. You know, growing up physically, said things wrong, you know, not going, her body wasn't working properly. And by the time she was 20, she lost most of her insides and in and out of hospital. But probably at the age of 38 or so, she was diagnosed with cancer. And we went through some things. Her mom really went through some things. Mm-hmm. And all I remember mostly during that time was that she would ask me to pray to God to take her home now. Mm-hmm. And I would mm-hmm. tell her, I can't do that. Mm-hmm. You know, I can't get that to that point. Because I wasn't letting go.
Right.
Took a while. And I see things different than my wife does. You know, I'm a different. God gives me all kinds of visions. But mm-hmm. in this case, it took a long time for me to release her. Mm. And she was in the hospital on her last days. And she was going through it. And she was in a lot of pain. And she looked up and she says, Dad, pray to God to take me, you know? And I finally gave in and prayed. And I left my family there at the hospital because we had things to do at home that I had to take care of. Before I made it back to the hospital, she was gone. God had taken her home. Mm. And it was a struggle. Mm-hmm. But God has never left me, and he didn't let her down either, because she's in a way better place than we are.
Yes.
So
yes.
That's how I see it.
Right. So that being said, what was you focused on? Jesus.
Yes. Well, maybe, it's like my wife put me in. I went to church. It was right. I went to church right after that. And my pastor looked at me and he goes, "What are you doing here?" I said, "I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing."
Mm-hmm. Right.
This is what else would I do? And stuff. And my wife had stayed home because she needed that. Yeah. She needed that.
Yeah.
But me, I needed to be reinforced by God. Mm-hmm. That this is, you know, this is it. This is how life goes. We're visitors here. So everybody goes at a different time. Everybody's got a story. Everybody's story is going to end different.
Mm-hmm.
And once we got through that, I mean, till today, I still remember her. I think about her. We did a lot of things together. She would have loved it here in Havasu.
Mm-hmm.
And she would have came with us.
Right.
Yeah. That's just the kind of daughter she was.
So everybody's walk is different.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody goes through different things.
Yeah.
For you, I know focusing on Jesus and what was taking place is what got you through that.
Mm-hmm.
Probably even learn to lean back into him a little more, like we were talking about this morning. The things that go on in our lives, but the things that God calls us to do, we just, for me, I lean back.
Hmm.
Lord, just, you know, Proverbs 3:5, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. Hmm. Well, the lean, you know, leaning into that is, as far as I'm concerned, is the leaning into your own understanding. Leaning back. I lean because I always go, okay, God, I'm leaning back into you and trusting you with all my heart, allowing you to do this. Help me through this. Give me the strength, the courage, the understanding, all of that. And he's always there, you guys. He's faithful, and he always comes through for me. I know that, and I know he came through for you.
Yes.
And that's really, really awesome. So I want to encourage you guys today to lean back into Jesus, whatever the situation may be, maybe a loss of a loved one, loss of a loss period is not an easy thing to deal with by any means, but I know God has a plan and a purpose for your life, and he will use it. I know he will, and now you can relate to people.
Yes.
Now that people come to you and go, "I just lost my daughter," you can be like, "Hold on a minute. Let me pray for you. Let me help you."
Mm-hmm.
Right? I think that's what takes place at this point. God takes the hurt that we had.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, for me, when I get hurt, he strengthens that relationship, first of all. And then second of all, he uses that.
Yes.
So that's really, really great. Would you change anything? Is there anything that you would change in, over the years of your walk with Jesus?
I think the walk has been what God's plan was for me. God had a perfect will for us, but we blew it right from the get-go.
Hmm.
You know, but then God has the will that he allows to happen in our life. And lets us flow through life. And that's why we stumble around. Mm-hmm. Like God didn't want a bunch of puppets. So he lets us learn by stumbling.
Right.
We stumble, we learn. We stumble, we learn. If we don't learn, we fall farther back.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to step forward, even if you're stepping backwards at the same time. You've got to go forward in the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because there's a prize waiting for us. Paul talks about it. Keep your eye on the prize. And a lot of us lose sight of that. We just lose sight of it. And that never changes. You know, a lot of people think, you know, our God is just this thing, and they put him in a little box and they try to box him up. God isn't in a box. He's all knowing. So when we move forward, that step we took, he already knew we were going to take it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why he sent his son Jesus here to give us a shot at eternal life in heaven.
Right.
This is what it's for, you know. Mm-hmm. We need to learn better. if we could just learn a little bit better, we would do a lot better. God doesn't need much of us to do good.
We were talking the other night. If we learned to listen better, wouldn't we be better off?
Yeah.
Right?
Uh-huh.
I don't know about you, but I have a listening problem. I think we just discussed all that, how God goes, I want you to go do this. And I'm like, no, come on. Really? But it'll be really, really good for you. Oh, come on. It can't be that good for me. But for me, I try to now, seeing God move in my life the way that he is, seeing what he's doing in ministry in my life, mm-hmm. and the way that he's just been working in my life, and just the accomplishments that, the hurdles that he has just wiped out of the way, the mountains that were in my way, he continues to change, so much. When we were talking last night in our group about having an attitude of gratitude, you know, you need to be thanking God, because I know God is working in your life. If you're truly surrendered to him and you're wanting him to work, he will work. He will.
Mm-hmm.
For me, he's blown mm-hmm. me away. I mean, he changed things that I didn't think he would. I never imagined him changing. You know what I'm saying? I didn't. Mm-hmm. Imagine him bringing me back to family. I didn't imagine him, you know, I never imagined being on a radio show by any means. You know what I'm saying? I never thought I was ever going to be in a place like this, reaching out to people and being able to just say, hi, I'm a grateful believer in Jesus Christ and God changes my life. So I just think we just need to learn to just listen.
Yeah.
Learn to listen, and learn to let go and let God.
Mm-hmm.
That is a huge, huge thing for me. Mm-hmm. Let go and let God, because I need God. I need him daily.
Mm-hmm.
And I pray to him, remind me daily who you are. And he does. He shows me just little tidbits. Mm-hmm. It just could be the roadrunner running across my path when I'm sitting there doing my job during the day mm-hmm. in the middle of the heat, just mm-hmm. sweating to death. But he does little things like that. The little roadrunner will come up. I had one just come up to me and look at me, and I was just like, hi, little guy. you're actually kind of cute. And he just looked at me, and I was like, yeah, that's a God thing. That's you know what I'm saying? Because when I was out in the world running amok, I had no intentions of ever stopping and looking at God's creation and, mm-hmm. and what it is. You know. But there he was, and I'm like, hi. You know, this is actually pretty mm-hmm. cool.
Yeah.
Thanks, God. You know? So... look for that kind of stuff. I ask him all the time, reveal yourself to me. Show me who you are. Show me who you are in creation. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm outdoors, and I know you used to work outdoors too all the time. And it's, isn't it great to just go outside and go, wow, you really created all of this for us.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are. We just don't listen. Yeah. And but it's so much better when we do. Mm-hmm. It really, really, truly is.
Amen.
And I am so grateful for that. So that being said, let's, we got a couple more minutes. Not much. Let's just talk about heaven. Can you just imagine what heaven is going to be like?
Can't wait to get there.
Right.
You know, and it sounds sad, but and friends talk to you, death is not an issue with me. If it's my time, God will take me home. And yeah, people will be probably sad, but don't be sad. Be happy, because I'll be with my God. My Savior, waiting for you to get there.
Right.
Because that's what we're doing. Mm-hmm. When we get to heaven, all we are is waiting for the rest of the family to come.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yes, and I'm jealous of the people that are already there. Yeah. You know, there's been times when I'm like, Lord, can we just go home now? Can we just be done with this?
Yeah.
So, mm-hmm. John, I just, we're out of time. I just want to. I want to thank you, number one, for coming and being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
I know it was a little bit of nerve-wracking, but mm-hmm. you did really great. I'm really encouraged by you. I pray that our listeners are encouraged by you. You have a strong testimony. And I'm excited to continue to walk in this life with you and just be an encouragement to each other, because that's, I know that's why God put you here. Mm-hmm. You already say encouraging things to me all the time, and I really appreciate that. Mm-hmm. I really, really do. So that being said, Bill, would you like to give us the rest of our sponsors?
Sure will. We want to say a big thank you to Just Garage Doors Now Hiring. They're located at 2555 North Kiowa Boulevard with Suite 100 and on the phone at 928-855-6331. Havasu Kindness, they have Lake Havasu souvenirs and Christian decor, hats, t-shirts, and more. Located at 2018 McCulloch Boulevard North and on the phone at 928-505-0451. They also want to remind us that kindness spreads joy. And ServPro of Lake Havasu City, Bullhead City, Kingman, they're family owned and operated with residential and commercial restoration and cleaning services. Located at 2775 Kiowa Boulevard North and on the phone at 928-855-9124. They also are on the web at ServPro Lake Havasu City, Bullhead City, Kingman.com. And Lynn's Little China, Christian owned and operated restaurant for over 20 years serving New York style Chinese food. 7 days a week, located at 1632 McCulloch Boulevard in Lake Havasu City at the Safeway Plaza, and also at 4120 Stockton Hill Road in Kingman.
Thanks, guys. Thank you, guys, for your donations and helping us keep going. Once again, Once again, you guys can reach us on the web. Our website is recoveryradiolhc.com. And our email is recoveryradiolhc@gmail.com. If you have a praise report, or if you have a prayer request, we would love to hear from you guys. If you'd like to be a guest on the show, we encourage that also. Or if you even have a topic that you want us to talk about and to cover, we would love to hear about that too.
And also, Sean, want to remind everyone that on Wednesday mornings at 1 to 2 a.m., this show will rerun for those that may work during this time and are not able to hear it. And they can also pick up the show on all the podcast platforms as well.
Amen. Thank you, Bill, for reminding me of that. I totally forget. You know that, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's usually not your area that you're talking about because you're hosting.
Right?
So, yeah.
It's kind of interesting being in the driver's seat all the time.
Yeah.
So let's do our closing prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for redeeming us, for giving us a new life, for making us a new creation. Mm-hmm. Thank you for setting us free from our past, making us right with you. We just love you, Lord, and we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Jesus' most precious name, amen.
Amen.
I just want to say, guys, we are better together. We can't do it without each other. Yes. We learned that today. And we love you guys. We're glad that you're listening. I am your host, Sean. And I ask that you guys just turn in next week, and we'll have another great show. We love you so much.
And happy Father's Day.
And happy Father's Day. And
yeah, to all the dads out there, I hope you guys have a great weekend.
Right. Thank you, you guys. We love you so much.
Goodbye for now from Recovery Radio, where we have hope for you.